أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم Our dear viewers, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace and blessings of Allah Almighty be upon you all. Welcome once again to yet another episode of Why Religion, coming to you from our MTA Gambia studios here in Talinding. I'm your host, Abdullah Diba. And as you know, while we bring different topics to you through this series of Why Religion, very important topics which we try to discuss through our panelists, different guests that we have here with us in the studio. And of course, it's our tradition to go out and ask people, as members of the public, to also share their understanding, their opinion, as far as the topic that we choose to discuss about is concerned. Today in the studio, the guest I have with you on my immediate right, I have Mr. Kemo Sonko, who is a member of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat, the Gambia, and he's also been serving in different capacities, in different offices, nationally, regionally, for the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat, and professionally, he's working with the Gambia Revenue Authority. And on his right, and to my far right, we have Mr. Musa Kinte, who's also a senior member of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat, the Gambia, also similarly has served in different capacities, different roles within this country. And he's also serving in the Gambia Revenue Authority. I welcome both of you and I'm honored to share the panel with you to discuss a very important topic. And today the topic we chose is marriage. Marriage is something that is essential in everyone's lives as far as religion or no religion is concerned. And today our guest will help us to have a better understanding of this topic of marriage. Starting on my immediate right, and I'll start with you, Mr. Sonko, as is our tradition that we start from the right, tradition of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If someone was to simply ask, why does someone need to get married? Why do we even get married in the first place?
Well, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa viewers. That's a very, very important question that you have asked. The institution of marriage, particularly in Islam, is very important. But not only in Islam, marriage is very, very important because we want to continue the procreation of the human race. If we don't get married, well, the human race, our procreation, will come to a halt at some stage, and then the human race will cease to exist. So therefore, if we get married and we are able to have progenies that are good, then it means the institution of marriage will continue to flourish, and it will continue until the end of time, and you will have that good progeny that will continue to live and remember God, worship God, and then, you know, fulfill the requirements of the institution of marriage.
When it comes to, you said, good progeny, I mean, we know that animals also procreate.
Of course.
They don't get married. So naturally, we don't need to get married to procreate. But
exactly.
You mentioned about good progeny. What does that have to do with, what is the connection between that and marriage?
Yeah, because the good progeny, if we marry based on the principles of Islam, we are sure that we will have a good progeny. And that the purpose of having that good progeny is to always remember that our purpose on this life is to worship our Creator, which is one God. And it is through the institution of marriage that we will be able to produce that progeny like you have mentioned. So the good progeny has a relationship with marriage, because fulfilling the basic requirements of marriage as stipulated by Islam will guarantee that good progeny.
Right, absolutely. And Mr. Kinte, if I could come to you, we do see some people who say, look, enough people are getting married, there's kids all over the place, what if I choose not to get married and just, you know, just do whatever I want? As for marriage, I'm okay. Enough people are getting married already. I may not need to get married specifically. What do you have to say about such a thought?
Well, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. First of all, I'll say my brother here has explained amply, you know, what benefits there are in marriage. The preservation of the race, preservation of quality, you know, because we know that inheritance is a reality, genetics is a reality, and we don't just pass on physical attributes. There are other attributes also that are passed along with the physical attributes. And that is the side, I think, that a lot of people tend to forget. Spirituality has a bearing, you know, this marriage and multiplication has a bearing on spirituality also. Because as we pray, we acquire some other attributes that are not just physical, right. Our spiritual attributes. And as we pray and pray for our progeny, when we marry, then that those attributes, those spirituality, good qualities of believers will continue to be here. That's one of the reasons also. So choosing not to marry is like bringing that to an end as far as you're concerned. What else is in marriage is that we age, you know, and as we grow old, we need assistance. And if you think you're going to need assistance in the future when you're not that strong, who's going to be there for you? This will make me tend to think of the welfare state in the West. In 2003, I went to attend our annual Jalsa. And as I was watching TV, I saw this case of a woman complaining, and she's threatening to take a care home to court because the mother was not treated properly. She was left to sleep on one side, and they were not turning her around. So she developed bed sores, and that led to an aggravation of her health condition. So I said to myself, what's wrong in you keeping your mother in your house? Because those people who are taking care of your mother don't have that sentimental attachment,
right.
You know, to right. have to make it their business. So that also is very important.
Right.
Imam Diba, putting religion aside,
right.
let's look at this whole issue of marriage from the vantage point of rationality.
Right.
We will realize that people got married regardless of religion. People get married, and they have given us the opportunity to be here today. Today, you and I are talking here. Today, tomorrow, you will be talking to somebody else who does not believe in even religion as such. You know, one of the, you know, the formal religions that we have, like Islam, Christianity, or any other religion, they don't profess to believe in any religion.
Right.
But through the institution of marriage, and here again, I'm not talking about Islamic institution of marriage, but marriage. Like you rightly said, some people will say, well, I don't want to marry because you have so many billions of people on earth now, it's enough. But the people who normally say this should realize that it was through this institution of marriage they were able to be on this earth.
Right.
And if you want to be grateful, you should continue the same institution of marriage to give opportunity to other people to enable them to interact like we are doing today. And exchange ideas and involve themselves in scientific research and so many other things that can bring about change. So the idea of not getting married to insist that there are already so many people on earth, to me, is not a very rationally,
right.
You know.
But one could argue, Mr. Kinte, that I can adopt a child and just take care of that child, and just to remain celibate. There are people who choose not to get married. As far as Islamic teachings are concerned, is it something that's encouraged? Is it discouraged? Is it not allowed to choose not to get married because of no other reason, but just I just don't want to?
As far as Islamic teachings are concerned, God has told us to get married. Mm-hmm. And he even started, I used to tease some of my colleagues with this, he started with two, and said three, four, up to four. But if you feel you cannot maintain justice, then you can marry one or that who your right hand possesses,
right.
Something like that. Okay, that I think is an injunction, and it's straightforward. We should get married. And the only reason why I can think of someone not wanting to marry is that if you have a problem, if you have a health issue, you're compelled in that case not to be married. Mm-hmm. And some people won't marry because they feel they don't have the means. But even in such a case, that is like temporary, mm-hmm. and you're supposed to pray and strive hard. But I say in that case, you should maintain your integrity, you should remain celibate and you know, ensure that you conduct yourself properly.
Yeah.
But like you have said, if it were, for instance, the teaching that if you feel like marrying, you can marry, if you don't feel like marrying, don't marry, and it was not the sunnah of the prophets, mm-hmm. then, you know, it would have, if everybody had behaved that way, like my brother said, we would have, this human race would have almost gone extinct, or probably would have run into serious human resource problems. Mm-hmm. And I think, in my humble opinion, one of the most important resources that God has created here is the human resource. Mm-hmm. I think it's most brave.
Economic stability is important. And then he just hinted at it. If somebody genuinely says, look, I just don't have the financial means to get married, what advice would you have for such a person?
Well, in the context of Islam, if you don't have financial means to marry, Islam has laid down certain rules that you can follow to be able to keep yourself, you know, safe from all the, you know, moral maladies that you would experience, you know, and that is to resort to, one of them is to resort to fasting, because fasting is very important. It instills discipline in you, and because you do not have the financial means, God has given you the guarantee that as long as you remain true to the teachings of Islam, you adopt the instruction to keep fast, Allah will open up a way for you. You know, so once God Almighty has given the guarantee and has given you the assurance that as long as you remain true to me, I will provide for you. But you can also, the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentioned that you can adopt fasting to instill discipline in you so that you can at least control yourself. So this is one of the ways that we can perform, or we can ensure that we remain loyal to the teachings of Islam and practice them as instructed by or commanded by Allah Almighty and the Holy Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And once we do that, we are safe.
Absolutely. But dear viewers, we've also gone out there, we've asked people questions, similar questions as to what their thoughts are about why do we need to get married, or can we choose not to even get married, how to choose a spouse, what's the right spouse for you. Let's see what their thoughts are, and then we'll come back here into the studio and continue the discussion. Hope to see you soon.
Well, in my opinion, I feel people get married because it's a religious thing. It's part of the religion. So that's why most people get married. Others do it because of they find someone they love and they want to spend the rest of their life with. Yeah, like a life partner.
We don't just come and jump in marriage because of what marriage is something that, you know, national, but we want it to be everlasting between, you know, exactly you and your example. You and your wife.
An ideal spouse. Someone who loves you and accepts you for who you are. And someone who brings out the better person in you. And then someone who generally makes you happy. A successful marriage is when you guys basically can be each other around, be each other's support system, talk to each other, and then communicate.
Welcome back into the studios, our dear viewers. We'll continue here with our guest that we have here. And I'll start with you, Mr. Kinte. When one now intends to get married, as you have laid out the importance of marriage, both, you know, rationally, morally, religiously, the person is now convinced that, you know what, I want to do this. I want a better spiritual upliftment. Morally, I want to be stable. I want to continue the human race. And now this person wants to choose a spouse. How does the person go about with it?
Well, yes, that's also a point that was raised, you know, in the past. And the holy founder of Islam, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, addressed it. And told the companions and all of us, because as it passes, the message passes on, that generally people, when they want to choose a wife, they do it for four reasons. One being the physical beauty of the person. The second one being his wealth, you know, how rich, how wealthy the person is. There's another one, what kind of family line he comes from, whether he's from a kingly class, you know, very prestigious family. That also is one reason why we marry. And then he said another reason is deen. And deen, when interpreted properly, is not just the name and surname. It means your way of life. Mm-hmm. So he advised us then, and that advice still sticks, that when a mu'min is choosing a spouse, he should go for deen. Mm-hmm. There is a lot of wisdom in this. Deen is the one part, at least, that guarantees the future. Mm-hmm. Just like I said, our qualities we inherit also from our parents, and therefore, if you are somebody who is pious, you're somebody who is righteous in your conduct, you're likely to impart that onto your family. You're the first school that the children will go to. You're the first trainer. Mm-hmm. So you will bring them up in a righteous and pious way. Mm-hmm. So therefore, that will ensure that those qualities are passed on to the succeeding generations.
Right.
That's important.
Right. Mr. Sonko, now we know that, you know, it's the faith of the person is important, but faith comes with a lot of things. Yeah. If we are defining for a woman who is an ideal husband, what kind of qualities is the woman looking for, should the woman be looking for? Or the man, what kind of qualities should he be looking for in a wife? What would you define as an ideal spouse in a marriage?
Well, the Holy Quran has taught us that as far as God Almighty is concerned, it is our righteousness that matters to God Almighty. Nothing else matters. Like my brother said, your family background doesn't matter, your wealth doesn't matter, your beauty doesn't matter, because all these things will come and go away. That's why Allah Almighty says, "Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum." The most honorable amongst you is the one who is righteous. So righteousness is very, very important, because if you marry a lady for the reason that she's wealthy, yes, you now know that she's ready, wealthy today, but is there any guarantee that she will be wealthy tomorrow? Mm-hmm. And if that is the purpose for which you marry her, if the wealth, you know, goes away, your love, your compassion for her, your relationship with her, will also go away. Mm-hmm. All of us, even apart from religion, in worldly affairs, you go to work. It's because there is a reason why you go to work, because there is salary for you. If at the end of the month you don't receive your salary, the next month you don't receive your salary, which is the purpose for which you are going to work, among other things. But that is one of the primary reasons why you are going to work. Mm-hmm. If you don't receive salary, you won't go to work.
Right.
So if the beauty, you know, which was the reason for you to marry that lady, is no longer there because she could fall ill and become, you know, bedridden, you know, and she's terminally ill, your love, your compassion, your relationship as a whole with the lady will vanish, will go away. That is why the Holy Prophet said, but even those who are sick, they are terminally ill, they can still be righteous. Mm-hmm. Those who are, you know, wealthy, they can still be righteous, because righteousness will enable them to spend that wealth in the cause of Allah Almighty by advancing the cause of Islam or any other religion that you belong to. So righteousness is the key.
Absolutely. I think that's important. But Mr. Kinte, of course, righteousness entails a lot of things, and we could probably go into the details of some of it. But in an ideal in an ideal marriage where two people want to live together, of course there are certain things that needs to be sacrificed. You know, somebody is brought up in their own household, they're used to certain things, they're used to doing things certain ways, and the man, of course, has been brought up in a completely different household. They come together, of course, not everything will be, you know, perfect. There are some things that need to be forgone. Maybe they're probably young, they don't have experience in it. What are some of the things that they can probably overlook and where to get, you know, advice from, who needs to kind of police them? Let's just give us a little bit of a guidelines on that.
Well, you see, it's interesting that human beings are social beings, and society has a role to play, a major role in our lives. Mm-hmm. And no wonder all the pious people of old, religion as itself, sees humanity as a society. And that social approach to issues is always there. Mm-hmm. From the very beginning, when the Islamic way of performing nikah, of marriage, is that you're called, the families, you know, negotiate the marriage. After you have chosen your spouse, maybe the first thing I always keep advising people is to pray. Mm-hmm. There is dua istihara, which is the best one, the best prayer that the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and his sahabi adopted. Before any taking any major decision, they will consult, they will seek for Allah's guidance. Mm-hmm. And that's the istihara. So after we've done that, over a period, I think it's 40 days, that's given as at least normal period for istihara. You then decide, mm-hmm. trust in God and decide. But in any relationship, marriage or any other relationship, in living in society itself, it is give and take. Mm-hmm. There are sacrifices that we do every day. Mm-hmm. When I was coming to this studio, the sacrifice I did was I left my family at home. There are other issues that I could be attending to. I left them. I paid my fare or drove my vehicle with fuel and everything and come here and do what I'm doing here now. Right. That's sacrifice. Mm-hmm. But towards an objective. The objective is so that we create this situation and explain things to people. This is counseling probably as we are doing now, yeah. for those who aspire to get married in the future. Mm-hmm. So that's part of the thing. A lot of counseling will be done. Ordinarily, normally, when young people get married, the parents are the first counselors that they have. Mm-hmm. Because at the very beginning, they will call them, they will agree on dowry, and some form of dowry will pass. Mm-hmm. And then after that, they will come congregate in a mosque. They will say prayers, they will announce the marriage so that the public is aware that now this woman is out of bounds for anyone else who intends to marry, she's already married. Mm-hmm. And everybody will know that this man now has a wife. So from there, and even during that process, the verses of the Quran that are recited, you know, are advisory in nature. Right. Telling the relatives to fear God, that's the number one thing. Mm-hmm. Fear of Allah is, if it is not the basis, whatever is built upon that one is bound to crumble. Mm-hmm. Because then there is no strong basis. Right. And fear of Allah requires that when you judge according to what Allah has laid down. Mm-hmm. A lot of houses are in trouble today because when we wake up in the morning, we judge ourselves what the best way we feel. Mm-hmm. You cannot judge your, it will be unfair to judge your spouse, your partner in marriage, according to your desire. What will you allow the reverse? Will you allow that person to judge you according to what he or she wants? Mm-hmm. So there must be a rule in the house.
Absolutely.
And that rule must be based on the religion that you have adopted, mm-hmm. in going into that marriage.
Right. So, Mr. Sonko,
so that's important. And the parents also must also keep counseling. Right. And until the thing gets solidified, mm-hmm. they need to give their experience to the children. Otherwise, mm-hmm. two people who are born in separate homes, like you have said, mm-hmm. are bound to have difference in their attitude,
right,
in what they like and don't like.
Yeah.
Not everything will be symmetrical.
The basis should be sacrifice, righteousness and sacrificing,
yes,
for the other person. When we look at a successful marriage, Mr. Sanko, in your opinion, what would you define as a successful marriage? What would you see in a marriage and say, this is successful?
Well, a successful marriage, I would call it a marriage that the spouse, the couple, understand. You know, in life, no two human beings are exactly the same.
Right.
We have different temperaments, we have different dispositions. So in marriage, we are supposed to study each other and know each other's weaknesses. Mm-hmm. And we should be, like the Holy Quran would say, a garment for each other. We cover each other's weaknesses. And then if we do that in our marriage, it will be a very successful marriage, because that marriage, if it is an Islamic marriage or any other marriage, I don't know if you say marriage, whether you are talking in general terms or mm-hmm. you have a specific, marriage life.
Let's look at it from an Islamic perspective.
From an Islamic mm-hmm. perspective, because all the rules are there. If we follow all the rules, like, we will become a garment. What is the purpose of a garment? Mm-hmm. Is to keep you warm, keep your identity, the secrecy, everything that is in marriage that is not supposed to be exposed, should not be exposed. And by doing that, we mean that we should know each other's shortcomings and look over those shortcomings, and then we will be able to live together. Mm-hmm. Because the way you observe people, there is one old man, I call it, he's a philosopher. I like to discuss with him, because the man, he passed away now. So much wisdom in him. If you converse with that man, you learn a lot from him. Mm-hmm. He said, the way you observe people, that's the way they observe you too. Mm-hmm. If you think they have weakness, they too know you have weakness. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's very difficult for one to discover delve in your own self mm-hmm. and discover your own weakness mm-hmm. and try to correct it.
Right.
That is the best way to go about it, but it's difficult.
Right.
Because when you look at yourself, you think, I'm okay. Mm-hmm. I have nothing to rectify, I have nothing to correct. Mm-hmm. But others who are looking at you from a vantage point know that you have a whole host of weaknesses. Mm-hmm. So with that consciousness, we should be able to cover each other's weaknesses, and then we will be able to.
Yes.
I think, taking from what he has said, mm-hmm. yes, the Quran has beautifully said, we are like a garment for one another. Mm-hmm. And that is, besides our weaknesses also, a garment, is for embellishment also.
Mm-hmm.
It's to make you look, beautiful, handsome, mm-hmm. So you're not complete, you're exposed without your garments. Your weaknesses will be seen, So that bit of it is very important. There's another term that the Quran has also used for a spouse. Mm-hmm. Said they are like your hearth, your farmland.
Mm-hmm.
Before you plant your seed, you first of all look at the land. You want to get a land that is fertile, where if you plant your seed, it will sprout, mm-hmm. and your harvest will be good. The focus is on the harvest, mm-hmm. and not just the land. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you'll go to sandy soil, and that will be a waste of your seed, because if you put it there, you don't expect anything good to come out of that.
Mm-hmm.
So that is why, in making a choice, the issue of taqwa, which is the fertility in just not body but soul too, that should be the focus.
Mm-hmm.
So that the progeny, which will be the harvest, mm-hmm. will be righteous people. So when you look at it that way, if someone asks me, what are the qualities that I should look into? What's an ideal marriage? I'll say, you need an ideal seed, and it should be planted in a very fertile soil.
Mm-hmm.
So the seed is the husband, the wife is the soil. If the seed is not good, never mind how fertile the soil,
mm-hmm.
the outcome will be bad.
So also, as he said, looking into yourself, you need to prepare yourself first.
Yes, there should be a preparation.
Mm-hmm.
What they do is grow this plant here, get the best seed,
mm-hmm.
and then go and, if the land is less fertile, put in more manure and turn it over and plow it so that it's all properly mixed. And you must wait for timely rain before you. So all that is part of this.
Yeah, and I think, Mr. Sankar, just to expand more on what you mentioned, most often when we are talking about looking for the right spouse, the person who is looking for the spouse is always focused on, is this other person good enough? The man tends to say, I'm looking for the best woman. And the woman also is looking for the best man. But how many times do we prepare ourselves? Am I good enough to attract somebody else? How important is that, to look into yourself and prepare yourself first before you even look for that best? Because everyone wants the best spouse.
Yeah, to prepare yourself, like we said, when we are talking here, during the course of our discussion, we are focusing on the issue of marriage from the perspective of Islam. And to prepare yourself, that is, financially you should prepare yourself, that is obvious. Because if you marry, you need to live a decent life. You know, everybody wants to live a decent life. And even Islam promotes living a decent life. That's why from the beginning we said, the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, if you don't have the means, you resort to something to keep your chastity. Financially, you should prepare yourself, but morally also you should prepare yourself, which is, in fact, the most important thing. Because even if you have the money, the means to be able to, you know, live with your wife comfortably, if you are morally bad, like my brother said, then whatever is going to come out of that marriage will equally be bad. And we said the purpose of marriage from the beginning of our discussion was to have a progeny that is pious, that will continue to remember God Almighty, and that will continue to remember God Almighty with the consciousness that the purpose for which we are on this earth is to worship our God, Allah Almighty. So the person who is looking for a spouse, you know, to marry, whether it is a man looking for a woman or a woman looking for a man, you know, that is the inner investigation that you must conduct. But like I said, it's very difficult for one to be neutral, you know, to be honest to oneself. You would want to be, but sometimes it's very difficult for you to delve into yourself, examine yourself thoroughly, and come out with this genuine, very truthful, you know, results that this is where I stand as far as the expectations are concerned, and how far can I go in trying to mend my ways and reform myself and get to a level which is acceptable. Of course, we will never get to a perfect level because it's an endless journey.
Right.
You know. So, in my opinion, that is the way we should prepare ourselves in trying to identify the right spouse.
Absolutely. Mr. Kinte, we talked about children being a very, very essential part of good progeny, as Mr. Sankar rightly said. Now, in maintaining a marriage, now that the person is looked, found, in their opinion, I found the best spouse, I did the istikhara and all of that, alhamdulillah, now they're in a marriage. But maintaining that marriage is also important. After you overlook each other's weaknesses, children coming in, what should be the priorities of, let's say, a young spouse, the first child, even before the child comes in, some of the preparations in giving that child a healthy spiritually, morally, and the household environment. Just give us a little bit of a snippet into that.
To start with, you will expect that by the time you want to bring in children that you're going to train to become, you know, good and righteous citizens of a community, you first of all will have to, the environment also affects the human being. So the environment that those children are supposed to grow in is supposed to be a very cordial and very harmonious environment. And that is a task that these newlywed couples will have to, you know, perform. And that's where I said sometimes they need wise counseling, they need experience. Very often in our these days, they will start off, you know, doing things that will not last. And that can put the marriage in trouble. If, for instance, Let's start with the very basic, probably, the sustenance in the house. Mm-hmm. Today, yes, you have a reasonably good amount of money coming in. The income is healthy today. You live in a certain way. Mm-hmm. And later on, you know, troubles come. Mm-hmm. If you're not psychologically prepared, you know, to deal with that kind of situation. And when I said prepared, it's not one side, but the couple themselves must understand that life is like that. It's like a seesaw. Sometimes you're up, there are downs too. So if that happens, you know, you must be psychologically prepared to deal with that. So that that harmony is there. And if a child is born in a home where you have that mutual understanding and mutual respect, trust, you know, the environment is healthy enough. You may not be, there is no perfection. There is no, mm-hmm. What they call, there is no utopia, mm-hmm. you know. But to the best of your ability, try to, you know, maintain that situation. Right. Incidentally, just before I came in, I was sitting opposite you. I just glanced at Buhari and I saw the story of Hazrat Ibrahim and Hazrat Ismail. When he went to visit him and found Hazrat Ibrahim went to visit Alayhi Islam, went to visit the son, Hazrat Ismail Alayhi Islam, and found he had gone out, but the wife was there. He asked the wife a question, where's your husband? He said he's left to look for sustenance for us. And he said, how is your living? How are you living? He said, it's hard. It's full of hardship. This is a terrible way of living. You know, so the picture that was depicted of the household by the woman was deploring. At the time, she didn't know that that was the father. And when the husband came back, was there any visitor? Yes, oh yes. An old man came, you know. He came here and asked about you, and I said, you're gone out. And yes, we spoke. But before Hazrat Ibrahim left, when he listened to all those complaints, the woman was whining, and finally gave her a message for the husband to say, if he comes, tell him to change the threshold of his door, gate. You know, some will say the lower sill of the door, whatever, the door sill. And when he gave him all the information and then said, but he gave me a message for you to say you should change the threshold of your door. And I said, that was my father. And what he actually has, the message that you have just given me, he is actually telling me to divorce you. Mm-hmm. So you can pack up your things and go back to your family. Mm-hmm. Then he got another wife, and Hazrat Ibrahim, after some period, came back again to visit the household and met again that Hazrat Ismail went out, you know, and when he came in, he met the wife and asked, after the son, and they said he has gone out to look for sustenance for us. And he said, how is your life? Interestingly, nothing has changed actually in their lives, but it's just the way the only change is the change of women. Mm-hmm. And this woman said, we are fantastic. Mm-hmm. Our life is okay. We can't complain. He said, what about the food? He said, yeah, we're eating, and we're eating good food. We eat meat, and you know, he said a lot of things, nice things. And then the father said, when he comes, tell him to strengthen the threshold of this door, mm-hmm. his door. Let him keep that door seal very good.
Right.
And when he told Hazrat Ismail, Hazrat Ismail interpreted it to say, that was my father. Mm-hmm. And the advice he gave is that I should maintain you and I should keep you mm-hmm. comfortable in this house. So you see the attitude, the first wife, you know, is complaining too much. And Absolutely. We have a lot of that in this, our generation. Mm-hmm. You know, women will be talking to other women about their fish money, how hard life is in the household. Mm-hmm. And instead of those ones counseling them properly, some of them will just tell you, I don't know why you have entered into this marriage in the first place. So you see, from there, the whole thing is crumbling down.
Yeah, I think it comes down back to what you also mentioned, that we should be governments for one another. Well, the conversation is getting more and more interesting, but I'm afraid that's what time permits us. And I'll thank you, our panelists. And I thank you, our viewers, for joining us. We will continue to bring you more interesting programs under your Why Religion. Until then, I say a very warm assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu to you. May the peace and blessings of Allah Almighty be upon you all.